late for the perpetually late faculty in this building, whichever building this is. And we will begin. Good evening. Welcome to the School of Architecture. Welcome to our Monday evening lecture series. I am doing this unplugged tonight because I don't want to mess up any of the other equipment that's going on. So I have no mic. Camera can give me lessons afterwards about how I can improve my projection, without assisted technology. We're very pleased to be able to welcome tonight our own Steve Everett, Professor of Music and Dean of the College of Architecture, Design, and the Arts. We will be having, right after the lecture, a reception in 3100 Octagon right outside the main office as a reward for all of you who have braved the cold and come out or stay on campus on a night like this. So please join us upstairs for drinks and refreshments afterwards. Before joining UIC as Dean of our college only 5 months ago, Steve was a professor of music at Emory University, where he served as Assistant Vice Provost for Academic Affairs, as well as Director of the Center for Faculty Development and Excellence. In addition, in discussions about the future of the university, and in particular the arts and humanities in the university, Steve is a leader in articulating and advancing the value, economic and cultural, not just for critical thinking, which is a commonplace, but for the value of creativity as a central marker of success, which, luckily for us in the college, is exactly the key thing that our college specializes in. Steve was also chair of the Department of Music at Emory, during which time he oversaw the successful completion of the Schwartz Center for Performing Arts 10 years ago. So among his other professional accomplishments and awards, Steve is the image of what the ideal client for architecture looks like. So pass him out your business cards, those of you on that side of the planet. However, tonight, Steve comes to us neither as an enlightened client, nor as an administrator, not that there's anything wrong with those things, but as a fellow cultural producer, scholar, and designer. Steve received his bachelor's and master's from Florida State University, and his doctorate in music composition from U of I. An award-winning trumpet player, composer, and conductor, Steve is an internationally recognized leader in the area of electronic music, and his recent compositions have increasingly engaged interaction and live performance, assisted by computer control electronics, with his work being performed in 27 countries worldwide. These compositions have received awards from, among others, the Rockefeller Foundation, the Asian Cultural Council, Chamber of Music America, American Composers Forum, and the International Trumpet Guild. Most recently, his composition, First Life, Imagining the Chemical Origins of Life, premiered in 2012, a multimedia performance based on chemical models generated at the Georgia Institute of Technology. An interest shared by many of the faculty, certainly in this school, Steve is also an expert in how sound generates and constructs spaces, and as well as how space affects and influences the composition and design of sound. Given these facts, many of you may now be wondering why we've invited Steve to perform in this particular space and lecture, either given the renowned acoustic disaster of the space and our defective professional sound equipment, it's an act of professional suicide, or it could be a stroke of genius. So if the school receives a large influx of resources to upgrade its equipment and remediate the space, the latter. Otherwise, regardless of how that goes, in addition to hosting leaders in architecture as conventionally defined, the school is always honored to contribute to showcasing a sample of the incredible talent and intelligence that the college has to offer. As we've done in previous forums, for example, the lectures by Bob Brugman, Peter Hales, and Marshall Lawson, we especially love the opportunity to steal the best ideas from our colleagues across the college. And we look forward to continuing our collaboration with the other units to make the college the premier place for cultural debate and creative thinking. It's a great pleasure to welcome our new dean, Steve Everett, to lead us this lecture.
We'll check on the acoustics for this room later. They are also the worst I've ever been in, I have to say. There's an interesting kind of resonance.
that happens in here. It takes a while to start EQ that up, but I mean, it's fascinating how you can build something in that really finds this one spectrum which you can't get rid of. And this building sort of has that, which is really fascinating. I'm already discovering that. I want to thank Bob for inviting me to come give this lecture. He and I have had a number of conversations since I have arrived, really around the relationship between sound and architecture. As a composer or sound designer, I tend to call myself more of a sound designer than a composer. Probably a fourth of what I do is designing architecture, because this whole question of sound really exists in a space, and much of the information that we get about a space comes through sound. So my career has really been focused on really what is that information that we're getting, how do we sensitize ourselves as designers to what is that relationship to the physical space, to the auditory space, to the visual space, the way cultures emerge from that, and so forth. So my lecture is going to be a quick survey of a number of sort of principles, a little bit of history, context. The field that I work in has really changed names a lot over the course of my career, and I'll talk through that. So we'll talk a little bit about the historical precedents for how my field of computer music and computer research has evolved since that came about. So I want to read just sort of one quick paragraph here. Music analysis, the aesthetics of music, and the psychology of music have all tended to treat music as if it were a phenomenon radically separate from the rest of the auditory environment. But music is bound up with that wider auditory world. It incorporates environmental sounds into its own material, and with the development of recording and listening technologies, takes on fluid relationships with the physical, social, and imagined spaces it occupies, from the practical and normative to the provocative and purely imaginative. One of the most powerful attributes of music is this capacity to simultaneously specify space and motion. Think before that. Both real and virtual, often pushing us toward inward and outward, metaphysical and transcendental realizations of our humanity. For me, music has always been this eternally fascinating activity of human existence. It is found throughout all cultures, and any time that you have any kind of metaphysical or religious epiphany that occurs in any society, usually music is the way you have it through that. There's something about the auditory domain and the way we process sound that has continually fascinated me throughout my life. Much of my research that I'm going to show you is really sort of a simple question, is trying to understand that reason for why this is so pervasive in human history. Does it have an evolutionary adaptive benefit? Is it something that is part of our intellectual social makeup that is we couldn't have without it? So here are the sort of categories that I want to try to quickly cover tonight. I want to give you the history context. A lot of what I do is, how do you build up sound forms? And with computer music, you can get into algorithm composition, which is really not a new thing. I'll show you a couple examples of how I've been involved in algorithm composition going back to Palestrina. Palestrina was a Renaissance composer, choral composer, who really, in some ways, was an algorithm composer, but used certain rules that were codified later, which I'll talk about. Simultaneously, Bob mentioned this project I did with Georgia Tech, where you take data, turn it into sound, and understand what you hear from that sound. I'll talk about intermedia, which is the relationship between all the media forms that has emerged in the last few years, hybridity as part of that, cultural hybridity. And then how do we perceive sound? A lot of what I do is now folding into cognition studies and neuroscience. So actually, I had dinner the other night with a neuroscientist at UIC who were working on a new project to really ascertain how rats perceive new kinds of sounds. And so that will be a little bit interesting kind of feedback already. Acoustic ecology, I'll talk about just a second. And then we'll talk about what are the new science spaces that are going on in 2014. When I was trained as a lot of composers are back in the olden days, to write concert music. Concert music is what you're training: music theory, music history, counterpoint, orchestration, all the different techniques that you learn are really designed for music that is to be consumed, performed in a concert hall. That's what pretty much our curriculum is still based on today. What I've discovered, though, is that how many times do we all listen to music in a concert hall? How many times do cultures really sit down and hear sounds in that setting anymore? So what's happened is I found my own life more and more. I'm moving outside the concert hall into these other genres. So for example, theater dance or vernacular traditions. contemplative music, film music, interactive multimedia, soundscapes, telematic, sonification. I've really done some of all those. And the other, the rest of the list, all my students are working in these fields. When you think about how much time people spend a day with sound coming into them, how is it coming into them? Is it coming in through a concert hall setting, or is it coming in through electronic devices and through various kind of media forms? So this list is a really changing dynamic for how we think about sound design and how we think about educating students who may be going into the next 40, 50-year career into this field. It's also what's emerged as a new field that really is called sound studies. There's a number of curriculum around the country that are focused on sound studies. It's a wide field of study. I mean, composition is the area that I work in, but it's really now consuming in psychology, different kind of science areas, this idea of intermedia, which I'll talk about in just a second, different kind of analytic structures are going on, plus engineering. So when I think about my own career, it really has been as much computer science and engineering, and now psychology is becoming the field of research, as well as composition and analysis. Because this is the field of sound, and how you understand sound, and how we really perceive sound, and how we create sound as designers. When I first started getting involved in electronic music, it was in the 1970s, I was just born then. But music concrète was really the first genre of music in the 1950s. Starting in the 1940s in Paris, it was taking a tape recorder and recording sounds. That really sort of morphed in the early 50s with electronische music in Germany, with Stockhausen, who started taking various electronic devices and making sound with them and recording them on the tape. By the 1960s, we do get the computer generating sounds. These are punch card computers, not real-time computers, but they were languages developed in the 1960s for computer music. Acousmatic music is a field that started to emerge. Acousmatic comes from the Greek term when you don't really see the original source of the sound. I think Aristotle preferred, or was it Socrates, who preferred to teach behind a screen because he did not want the students be caught up in the personality of the teacher. And he wanted the students thinking about the concepts divorced from the person who's delivering them. So there was this kind of sense of acousmatic teaching, pedagogical styles. So that really, there's a lot of composers now who call themselves acousmatic composers because they don't want to deal, for you to ever see the original sound source. So it's purely electronic and purely done in an electronic medium. Electroacoustic music is when you combine acoustic instruments with electronic instruments. And for many years I started calling myself an electroacoustic composer. That still makes sense because I do electronics with acoustic instruments. Eventually, 1984 was revolutionary because the Mac computer came out and everyone started to experiment with the capability of turning the personal computer, into some kind of interactive machine that would respond to gestures coming into it. So I started working in interactive computer music in 1985, and when I was finishing at University of Illinois, and at that time Macintosh had just come out. Apple hired me as a consultant to sort of go around and give demos of what I was doing, and it was very primitive, but it really was the first way of sort of showing how this computer could work live input coming in and out. That morphed into algorithmic composition, which became the thing in the 1990s. Today we really have something with sound design, and this concept of intermedia, which we'll talk about in just a second, is now sort of taking over. Intermedia, at the heart of how I use that term, is where it's not multimedia, it's intermedia, meaning that the media forms are informing each other. So you have some information from the auditory, which may be informing the visual, or you may have something from the kinesthetic or the physical space, which informs another media form. So it has to do whether they're not separate forms put together, but they're actually focusing on each other. So history and context will be the first section. Probably the starting point for all of this would be with Russolo, one of the futurists, Italian futurists, and this work, L'Arte dei Rumori, which really is the art of noise. And this is where he basically said, he argues that the human ear has become accustomed to the speed, energy, and noise of the urban industrial soundscape. This new sound palette requires a new approach to musical instrumentation and composition. So he invented this instrument you see here below, which is an antenna Rumori, which would be industrial sound. So there's scrapers and things in these things. So you put together a whole orchestra of really the quality of noise. So if I were to talk about what is the dividing point between the history of Western music and a kind of a new paradigm of thinking, I really think it's really 1913 with this work. Because noise and the acceptance of noise as a desirable source of sound in a composition really then takes off. And so much of what I do is work with the noise as the primary material to start with, and then we shape it from there. Another important person in my history has been Laszlo Mahajanovic, and this really gets, he was more one of the first, in my mind, one of the first people exploring intermedia in the way he looked at different kind of objects. For example, if we take a look at his light space modulator, this is always fascinating to me, this work, which tries to take the idea of space and form in 3D, but you put light into it, and then it has all these interesting refractions. But the thing itself is also a kind of a very interesting kind of sculpture that's constantly in motion. So I always loved that work of his. This work, the Neue Gestaltung in der Musik, it was published in Der Sturm in 1923, and this article was really a conversation he had with the Dutch artist Piet Mondrian, in which he was, Mahajanovic was really trying to find a way that he could compose new music by etching sound directly onto a surface. So in some ways, he was really way ahead of trying to visualize how can we take the idea of music being composed graphically. And this idea, which in 1923 was his quest, really becomes realized a little bit later with this composer. Yanis Xenakis is probably one of the most important composers in my field. This book, Formalized Music, 1963, it really is a book of mathematics, probability theories, and stochasticism is the theory that he worked in. When I started reading the book, I was a math major in college, so I had a little bit of background, but I could not really figure this out, because he assumes that you really had graduate calculus courses when you read this book. So when I was in grad school, I just took a summer and took an independent study with a mathematician to teach me this book, because I was struggling trying to understand it. So it really sort of opened up how you can think about the idea of probability in a radical new way. And the book of Music and Architecture, which was put together in 2008, which is, for you guys, you might be very interested in understanding that. Xenakis, probably most people know Xenakis because he worked in Le Corbusier studio in Paris from 1950 to 1953. And he was asked by Corbusier to design the Brussels World's Fair, the Philips Pavilion there. So when Xenakis really wanted to think about how to do that, he had been working on this earlier work called Metastasis, and I'll show you some sketches for that. So this is a hyperbolic parabola pavilion they exhibited in 1958. I think Jersey was at this, I believe he told me. Xenakis composed a piece, Concrete PH, which as you walked into the pavilion, you would be hearing that piece. Once you got inside the pavilion, there would be an 8-minute work composed by another composer, Edgar Varese, called Poème Electronique. So the impetus for that was this piece of Metastasis, which is a 61-piece orchestra. Xenakis was composing at the time, and he was drawing these glissandos between instruments, and he started noticing this sort of mathematical sort of shaping that was done with that. So he really wanted to take that idea, and as he developed the score for Metastasis, he really wanted to take that sort of mathematical structure that was emerging out of the way he wrote that score. Here's the sort of the final score for where he looked on that. Just for a quick, here's the end of a section of Metastasis where you'll see it's organized according to concepts of continuity and discontinuity.
Hyperbolic parabolas adorned with loudspeakers. The Corbusier coordinated the show inside the pavilion, a sound and light electronic poem. The sound component was entrusted to the musician Edgar Ballas, with an added interlude, concrete pH, realized by Xenakis. The poem is 8 minutes long and tells the history of humankind in 7 sections, which the two artists dealt with independently. Le Corbusier himself was responsible for the visual show, made up of color ambiences, a moonlit, 3 small images around the screen, a sun and a moon, clouds, lightning, stars, and 2 3D objects hanging from the ceiling. The whole show was written on a score that describes the time schedule of events, second by second. The sound was delivered by 350 loudspeakers, which formed sonic paths, along which the sounds created by Ballas and recorded on 3 tracks were routed according to the instructions of a control tape. Thus, the poem Electronique was born.
Thank you.
because he worked for a long time at various studios in Paris, got to know Pierre Boulez quite well. Pierre Boulez, who actually comes to Chicago quite often as a conductor of the Chicago Symphony, he was conducting back in the 1970s, he was conducting the New York Philharmonic. The French president, Georges Pompidou, hated the fact that the greatest French composer was working in New York. So he asked Pierre, what would it take to get him back to Paris? And Pierre thought about it, and he said, okay, I've got an idea. If you will give me a zillion French francs to start a new music research facility. And so he said, okay, you got it. And he said, well, but one of the conditions, that the French government has no rights over that money. I have total control over it, which he understands the French bureaucracy. So Pompidou gave in, and so we have now the center, the IRCON, which is where I've gone for many years. It's probably the most important research center. But it's not just about music. It really, what they have are hundreds of researchers working on various projects that are working on acoustics, they're working on psychology, all different art forms. It really is an extraordinary facility. For those of you who've been to the Centre Pompidou in Paris, you may remember this little pond that's there outside the Pompidou Center. And this was Jean Tinguely, who was the artist for that. But the entrance over here is right, that's the entrance, and there's the little pond here. So everything's underground. Well, this is above ground now, but originally everything was underground, which was kind of great because you would go there and you would spend days underground with no sunlight. And then came this weird psychology would emerge, you're like doing molds and working underground, this kind of stuff. And then you kind of come out and people smoking cigarettes up here and by the pond all the time. But this is an interesting space. This is the performance space or the research space, which was designed to really understand how acoustics can change. So all the walls are different materials that you can change it out of. So you can start to really understand how sound reflects. So it's a really experimental research space for acoustics. So whatever the performance is there, that's I think one of the more interesting places to kind of see the various ways that you can go into a space and hear the various response of the walls themselves. Boulez had started a music ensemble called the Ensemble Antiquitibarin, which was the, at the time, the highest paid orchestra in Europe. I worked with them. They are the most incredible musicians you've ever seen. They sort of outgrew the space here. So what he did, he started talking to the French government about building another space where the ensemble could be. And they also decided to bring in the Paris Conservatory, which was the oldest music conservatory in the world. So what they did, they came up with this idea of the Cité de la Musique, which is part of the La Villette. La Villette is a huge 80-acre park that has been developed. I'll talk about it in a second. But at the edge of that is this whole area here, which is, this is the Cité de la Musique. And you'll see there's an entrance here. There is a concert hall where the ensemble now performs. This whole thing was really designed around, was designed by Christian de Portzamblarck, who is a, you have to be a French architect to work on a French project. So some of these are loosely French, they can be Swiss or something, but almost everybody has to be French in there. But he's a Pritzker recipient. But this is really an amazing space, because everything's designed off music curves and sound, so it really is an architecture, which at the heart of it is really trying to capture going into a sonic space. So when you're there, the acoustics are really fascinating, but also just the space itself feels like you're in kind of waveforms as you're in space. So and here again is the big part. So the Cité de Musique we're just looking at is right there. This is a big open area, this big pavilion here. This is the Paris Conservatory of Music and Dance. This is a zenith, which is like a big concert hall for Lady Gaga and big traveling groups. This is the largest science and industry museum in Europe. This is a guild with the Omnimax in it. There are these strange little things, and it's Bernard Schumi, who you may know, the architect of Yale, who has worked a lot with, he and Peter Eisenman were both friends with Jean Derrida, and this whole park was really his concept of a kind of deconstructionist idea. He wanted to deconstruct the idea of a park. So Bernard always thought that parks are for relaxation and for indulgence. So he wanted to do something that was not for relaxation and indulgence, but for stimulation and surprise. So everything, as you walk around, there, they have these little red things that have no function. They're just kind of surprising everywhere. What's interesting about this park is there, one thing that's missing in it is a big concert hall for some of the big orchestras in Paris. So a few years ago, they decided to complete the park, and they are now building the Philharmonie, which is a Jean Nouvel project, and that's the outside of it. It should be open next summer. I'm going to go for the opening of it. This is the inside of it, and the reason I'm going to talk about this is the acousticians who designed this, Toyota, Hiroshima Toyota, this is a 1 to 10 size scale model. So if you look at it now, you can see it inside here. This is how you design a true architectural sound. Each of these little figures is a microphone. And when they test this, they actually have impulse response sounds that they make inside on the stage. And each of these microphones is measuring what kind of content is coming to them. They will seal this with nitrogen, encapsulated sealed space with nitrogen, so that you have pure electronic circuitry in there. But this is how you test the acoustics of the space. This whole space is really modeled on the Berlin Philharmonic Hall, which was built in the 1970s, which is, other than shoebox, which is the Concertgebouw, many of the Boston Symphony, all the great symphony halls are often shoebox space. This is the other alternative model, which is also considered one of the best places to hear symphonic music in. So this is a model based upon the Berlin Philharmonic that Toyota really designed and Nouvel. So what they did is they took a convolution reverb approach to that. So what they do is they make an impulse response, and then they record that sound when it comes back from the space itself. So it's, when you make an impulse response, you're actually recording the architecture of the space into a model. So when I compose, I use impulse response designs that I put my sounds into. So, for example, when you are here, let's say the sound is coming from the stage, the red line is the very direct sound. So that's the sound you're hearing first. But remember, the sound is bouncing off all these walls. Depending on the surface texture of those, will depend on how many early reflections, and then reverb gets into after a few milliseconds, once the sound is basically saturated, you're getting into a continuous stream of sound. That's what we call reverb. So what these impulse response do is allow you to model that. So this is the software. I'm actually going to take you to the software really quickly so you can actually show you. This would be, for designers, I think, and architects, this would be really worth pursuing if you want to really test out what something you're building would sound like. Because let me show you some of the models that I've invented. Okay, so this is a sequencer program, and which I've got, for example, this is a, I just ordered something, let me do this one. Okay, here is, first of all, the sound unprocessed. This is Mass Show, it's a 14th century Mass. It's written for cathedrals, obviously, in Italy, Europe, that would be 80-foot ceilings, concrete, probably a reverb time of 12, 13 seconds. So the music is structured to be in that kind of space. So what we're hearing now, the composer would have never liked this, because this does not have the 13 seconds of reverb going against it. But we can put that into sounds like CRE. with 0.1 second invert time. So you have all of these. So these are all models that you can put any sound into. So now the this sounds better once it is in some kind of larger unit of sound. Let me go over to another sound, and this is another. This is a piece that I wrote quickly for a musician in San Francisco who wanted a piece based on some William Faulkner text. So this is just a piece for voice and guitar. And let me take this
off. We should stop.
So this has a very intimate quality to it. It's just voice and guitar. There's nothing wrong with writing poems.
Thank you.
2017 is an estimate of when it might be open. So it's been a 14-year project. I thought it was ironic that they used Brahms' First Symphony as the music for this. That's the last movement of Brahms' First Symphony, which Brahms, it took him 21 years to write the symphony. So I don't know whether they did it on purpose, but I thought it was quite a nice smile when I heard that. Another project that I worked on, this is one that Bob referred to, that we did not build this one, but we worked on it for 6 years and paid $3 million for Peter to design it, but we never built it. This was the arsenal in Marina with another building. There's a book about this, Emory Games, which he really talks a lot about his principles on this. I worked a lot with Peter on this and talked a lot about Derrida, Chomsky, and Nietzsche, I think, were who he was into at the time. This really was really the building was really about this idea of folding spaces, which he wanted to connect the idea of this being an art space. So he measured the center of campus to where the building is, and then he calculated all the overtones of a waveform coming from the center of campus to this building. So many of the angles are really calculated off a series of resonating frequency bands coming from the campus, because he wanted the building to resonate with the campus. He also had another waveform coming from the center of Atlanta to the building, which came from the other side. So the building had a resonance with both the city and the campus at the same time. I've got these models. If you ever want to watch and see them, they're really great. You won a lot of awards for this, but okay, quickly, algorithmic composition I mentioned. How we make algorithmic composition, there are really sort of three general approaches. Stochasticism is a type of probability theory where you, for example, in music, what I love about music is that you can't always predict what's going to happen in music. I tend to write music which will have some unpredictable kind of behaviors. So if you give performers some chance to make a few decisions in that. Obviously, if you notate a score very heavily, you're taking away decisions from the performers in that. So, but stochasticism is this idea that you build models which have probabilities and pathways, but you don't determine which pathway. So stochasticism is what Xenakis came up with. That's the first thing that I studied. This idea of rule-based, really, this was, go back to what I was talking about Palestrina. If you ever take a course in 16th century vocal polyphony counterpoint, I'm sure many of you will. There's a text that is taught by Johannes Fuchs. In 1725, Johannes Fuchs basically created the set of rules that Palestrina worked under in the 1590s. So you study these, what's called species counterpoint. And it's these series of 26 rules. If you follow all these rules, your music will sound like Palestrina. So it's very much a rule-based system. But Palestrina followed those rules too, with very little divergence. And that's why it made me understand why I never liked Palestrina. Because it was so predictable, it was so rule-followed. I love Josquin the Prior, who broke all the rules. And I guess that's been my attraction. So what you're looking over here is the third. This is moving into more artificial intelligence, where you have Markov models. You have multiple frameworks of probability factors into it. This is a program called Open Music, which was developed at UCOM, the place where Pierre Gillez developed. So this is a piece that I was working on, and I'll show you this in just a second. But this is just kind of a typical kind of algorithm model, where you build pathways to determine. So that music that came on at the end down there was not something I wrote. It was determined by these probability factors that I set up and list. So you generate lots of raw material through this process of probability. But David Cope also has worked with artificial intelligence programs. So I want you, this is a test. I'm going to play a little musical excerpt, and I want you to tell me who the composer is. First one you throw an answer is extra budget. Who owns this piece? Who gets royalties from it? Weird question. So this idea of, I mean, you didn't do the whole proposal, so Chopin's very good too. I didn't play Chopin because I thought this would be easier to recognize, but I usually do Chopin in my classes. And invariably all the piano majors go, oh yeah, that's a mazurka. Which one is it? I don't remember, I haven't heard that one. But it's so clear, it sounds just like Chopin. So the question of this is, if we can model human intelligence, then can we just tap into eventually, which we can, probably in a few years, we'll be able to capture what you want in your aesthetics, and then have music that really comes out of your own imagination, that is your composition, but all you have to do is just imagine sound, and it'll be there, some piece will write it. So here's the piece, that just a quick, that I wrote for string quartet that was used on that algorithm you just saw. This is the end of the piece. It's a long piece, but this is where things start to stabilize and we start to move into kind of the ending stability of the quartet.
Where they're looking for ways of using the data. I was approached
last year, or 2 years ago, by a new center that was funded by NSF and NASA. It's called the Center for Chemical Evolution. And they have got researchers all over the world which are essentially what they're trying to do. They're trying to figure out how life got started on the planet 3.5 billion years ago. Apparently, 3.5 billion years ago is the first time microbes emerged on the planet. And they, as far as I can tell, proliferated the planet pretty well. So from there, you can start to detect how evolution is carried on from that point forward. But the question has always been, where did we get these microbes from? How did we move from inorganic chemistry to organic chemistry? So what kind of conditions actually made for organic compounds to make polymers, all the building blocks of proteins, which are part of amino acids, which then give us DNA and RNA? So that's the central question. So part of these large $40 million grants is the government requires that you have some way of explaining what you're doing to the public. So rather than doing a series of lectures, a couple of the scientists that I know, Georgia Tech and Emory, Martha Grover and David Lynn, approached me about doing, could we have a musical performance which tries to demonstrate the research we're doing? So I thought that was an interesting challenge. I didn't know a lot about biochemistry at the time. 2 years later, I have quite a few biochemistry books. Still don't know much. So I decided to try to take their data and sonify it, but also work with that data like I always do in an automated fashion as a way of parameters for writing for a string quartet again. So the first thing I got from Martha was this visualization of some data. This was her first hint. These were four molecules, much like the Miller-Urey experiment of 1953 at the University of Chicago, which first demonstrated that chemistry can evolve into organic compounds. She took those four molecules and did a simulation where she started to see these clustering of molecules. So the little red, the denser, the darker the red, you get a more dense construct. So under certain heat, under certain conditions, she could model organic compounds coming together. So I took that information. How do I then turn that into sound? Challenge. So I was able to get the original numbers data coming from that in an XYZ coordinate, because you've got an XYZ model, but also you've got the density of the Z coordinate. So that gave me three different parameters I could work with. So then I had to figure out how do I approach that driven cell. I can do it through modification. These are different approaches you can do. I tended to do parameter mapping sonification and model based sonification. Won't get into this. Maybe another lecture we can get deeper into sonification. I want to kind of move quickly through this. So then my next question is, well, which parameters of sound do I map those numbers to? Most sonifications I can't stand. As I started listening to a lot of sonifications, people will map parameters of data to a MIDI file to change pitches. So you hear some piece, that's all it is, just this MIDI file, some pitch. Drives me crazy, because there's no musical quality in that. So I'm really starting, I wanted to step back and think, could I look at every part of what happens in sonic evolution? Could I map data to each one of those and make it a much more rich environment of how we shape sound? The other thing I was looking at, since I was writing for a string quartet, you know, what's great about a string instrument is that it's one of the best controllers for sound that we've ever had on the planet. When you're playing a violin, you're making about 15 to 20 decisions simultaneously when you're playing the instrument. So the performer is controlling the bow speed, the weight of the bow, whether you put the bow close to the bridge or the fingerboard, how fast you move the bow, whether you start at the tip or the front, whether you tilt the bow slightly, get more hair against the string or not, whether you vibrato, whether you play on the G string or the D string, whether you portamento, whether you slide between the two, all those are decisions that are not written in the score. They're just chord notes written in the score. So all those other 25 variables that the performer's making is the expressivity that we hear from that instrument. That's why it's such a great instrument. That's why people have written for that instrument for years. So if you know you're a good violinist, a good classical music fan, within a measure or two, will say, oh, that's Joshua Bell. Oh, no, that's Isaac Perlman. Whoever. Because there's so many variables that are so customized to that person. So I wanted to kind of see, could I put that data to basically have customization of just one instrument and create a physical model in the computer of a violin with all the variables of weight density and everything in that. And so that was the next phase that I did, was try to create some data. So here are the stages, the design stages, for creating this piece. I first collected my data. These are some particular proteins that I started to work with. I started to analyze those proteins through this database. I visualized them through a Python program called PyMill. We'll get into that in a moment. Then the third phase was to take the streams of data and turn it into this. And you'll see, this is a very simplistic version. What's happening when I turn this on is, this is being routed to a physical model system. The called open sound control, don't worry about that. But down here you'll see, every once in a while, these pitch collections will change. This was being controlled by a Markov model, a stochastic. I didn't know when these were going to change, when these pitches change, so I can show you. So this is just a simple version, but you'll see these pitches will change every once in a while, but I have no idea when, because it will change the scale when it wants. So that it's just the stream of data that's coming into this, and then that's what's going into a physical model, which we're going to listen to at the moment, which is a simple sound system. So this way, I have unpredictable stochastic processes of this data coming in through. Then I wanted to take the 21 primary amino acids that are part of our body and map them to a certain scale. So those scales we're just looking at how they would change are correlated to certain amino acids that were found in those other kind of modules I was looking before. The other thing I wanted a lot of performer interaction. So this is basically just one max patch where there's about 15 or 20 different effects that'll be triggered by the data. So when the violinist is playing, sometimes it'll be a chorus, sometimes it'll be a big room reverb, the next minute it'll be something else. So each of these different things will be triggered on the violin as it's playing, coming off the data. So here again, I don't control what's happening in that, another stochastic process. Then this is physical modeling. So these were the variables that I designed in the physical modeling. This is another system called Kima, where you build up in different ways that you have variables that can be affected by the input. And I'll play this just a second. The other thing I wanted is I wanted to have the performers or the audience to be performers in this as well. Because I wanted, as you come into the space, I wanted you to feel like you were coming into early Earth. So the hall, I had projections going all over the hall. I had this, do you know what a connect is? I should have brought in my connect. A connect is an infrared device, this Xbox, Microsoft Xbox, where you can play games in front of it. Because it's reading, and you can put 15 data points on the body. And here again, each data point can be an X, Y, and Z coordinate. So I can take an Xbox or a Kinect and put it on me, and you'll see just this kind of shadow of my silhouette. But I can put data points over 15 points on the body. So I can have 45 different streams of information coming off the body. So I could route those 45 different streams into each parameter of a violin. So I could be playing a violin, but with my whole body, whereas my foot would be controlling the bow pressure, my hand would be controlling something else. So that was an interesting part of how we could take the entire body as a controller and a sound. So that was the next phase of this. As the audience walked in, I didn't say anything, but I gave them little clickers and little shakers as they passed out the programs. I had this set up so it was only audience. So they were playing and they were waving. They were playing with their clickers. This was before the concert. They didn't know, but I was recording all this. And then that became the opening section of the piece, was them looking at themselves. Because I wanted them to realize, when they're trying to figure out on early Earth what was going on to make life, everything in the environment is possible. That's why NASA was finding this, because NASA, some of the credible theories about life is that most of the organic compounds that have been found have come from meteorites. And so there's some credible theory that life got started through material coming from outer space. So we're all aliens. So here's a little animation of some of the sonification of the data. Sonifications for a string quartet. There's one. going to buy the space very abruptly. So they had to divide each piece in many different spots and try to play that way. This is where I put the connect on the violin. So the violinist is moving, but his information is determining that live patch that I was showing you before. So there's a lot of noises.
Called Kievan Manier, which was based upon this
political dissident, Pramitya Anantatur, and the puppeteer Vidyanto, who's a Javanese puppeteer I work with. I worked with this for several years to try to capture. So I had sensors on the screen so that the shadows, whenever the shadow would trigger certain sounds, there were microphones on the puppeteer, and so forth and so forth. Here is Pramudja. Pramudja was one of the most important writers in Indonesia. He died a few years ago. He was under house arrest. Well, he was under isolation in prison for 12 years on the Buru Islands. He wrote this four novels without pen or paper in prison for 12 years. I know, I talked to Salman Rushdie, who was in Emory last year, and he remembers in London there were these protests that would happen in Trafalgar Square trying to get Pramudja out of prison back in the 1970s. Jean-Paul Sartre sent him a typewriter because he wasn't allowed to have pen or paper. Everyone was trying to get him out of prison back in the 70s. The Jimmy Carter administration finally put pressure on the Suharto regime to let him out of prison. He was put under house arrest. I visited him a couple of times there. He gave me all these materials, which if I had been caught with those, I would have been put in prison myself. All this stuff was banned. So it was my cloak and dagger phase of my life. I also went to Amsterdam, and this is where, for me as a musician, understanding culture and how to be representational of culture is an important part of what I feel my responsibility as a designer is. So in doing this piece, I felt like I needed to do a lot more research about this play that he was keeping my ear, which was written by Tour. It was written in this one palace. So I went to Amsterdam to research everything I could find out about this one palace in the 19th century. So these were photographs that I found in the Private Institute in Amsterdam that really were from the 1860s in this palace. So I really modeled it on this. This is the wife of the Sultan, and this is Susuhan Pakubuwono IX, and that's his wife. When I saw the picture of his wife, I really was just mesmerized. And because a lot of my work has a kind of a social justice part of it, where I'm not just designing because I'm interested in design, I'm designing, does it have a social, sociological or socioeconomic or health benefit, or does it have some kind of way of being benefit of, to people's lives? So this woman's face just, I kept staring. When I was looking at these photographs for several hours in the Tropic Institute, I came upon this one and I suddenly felt like I wasn't looking at her, she was looking at me. It just sort of caught me that she was just sort of talking to me. So this whole piece became about her. So here's a quick piece.
To have to find the gift the other hand. You agree?
Performer in New York, and with high bandwidth connectivity, they can be performing could have a, in this case, this is a video of a dancer who died a few years ago, and then you sit down and you have a choreographer with her, and she interacts with you. So it's like you can bring people back from the dead through this kind of telematic performance. So telematic is a huge area that I work in now. This one is becoming another one, which is network, where you do live coding and performance. So we just had, this is a CHUP program demonstration, which we just had at the Innovation Center. We had Bill Wong from Stanford, who's an old student of mine, who developed the CHUP language. So these people are all running CHUP, and they're programming live, and the audience watches what they're coding. So everybody has to code live, but the audience gets to be part of the process. So network music and coding is a huge part of what's going on. Mobile phone orchestras are now, almost every city has a mobile phone orchestra. The Stanford, and that's Bill Wong playing guitar. He's the one who started it in Princeton, then he started here. I like Helsinki because they've got BMW funding their advertisements for their mobile phone orchestra. University of Michigan, their mobile phone orchestra. So now it's, you design your instrument, you have those speakers that you wear, you'll see. So you can wander around performing, you don't need space anymore for this. This is a little device, it's an EEG machine, which I've got one of those, I've been writing a piece now for this, but you'll see University of Michigan has the Mind Ensemble, a new media performance group that utilizes custom interfaces to explore the mind-machine connection. At Rensselaer Polytechnic, this was a performance using that device, you put it on the head and the performer has to meditate to get into alpha waves. If you can isolate your meditation deep into alpha waves, the deeper you get into alpha waves, the more the lift raises you up. So the goal is to get deep into meditation so you can go all the way to heaven. And so the audience watches, and also as you get higher, it changes the light, and the sound is also tied to that. So it's this idea of going deep into meditation for that. And then this is Katinka Klein, who is a cellist for the Chicago Symphony, who I've met when we've been working with, but she also uses this in a lot of her solo and cello performances now. So this idea of using the brain directly to be able to shape what happens in sound. I was trying to think of how architecture could use EEGs in architecture. I haven't come up with that yet. If you have any ideas, you know. And finally, this is a robot at Georgia Tech that plays marimba. So this is one of the commissions I've got finished this year. We got it to build this with a friend of mine. His name is Shimon. He's a robot. I'll just let Shimon speak for himself real fast here. We'll take another minute. The little iPhone app. You can make up the notes for the iPhone app.
The idea of design and the profession of designer has to be transformed
from the notion of a specialist function into a generally valid attitude of resourcefulness and inventiveness, which allows projects to be seen not in isolation, but in relationship with the need of the individual and the community. This was by Maslow in 1947 in his Vision in Motion. So I thought that was very relevant for sort of capturing how I sort of believe that, that idea that as designers, the better designers are ones who are really understanding all the different components for how to use, you use other kind of tools, how you use technique, which is the foundation for material understanding, for the technical ability, whether that's algorithmic, whether it's mathematics, understanding your design principle, to be aware that you're designing from culture. There's a sense of reverie that's important for me in the arts, that it doesn't become just a technical exercise, that it becomes something where you go into a kind of an imaginary state. Because people imagine the building they go into, they imagine the sound they're about to hear. They're evoking imagination. It's an important part of what I've always felt is my job to do for the listener. Intermedia, having some way that we cross over media forms, to me is available today, and what is one of the most interesting platforms to work in. Understanding how people perceive the psychological dimensions, where culture plays into that. Understanding that there's an acoustic ecology to all of this, that there's a sense that in the environment, who we are, the sounds themselves, the materials, everything is one big ecology. And then we think about what we're doing from an acoustical and ecological standpoint, it means we have to include everything. And then in the end, we're trying to really do something that is bettering human development. In some ways, this is the social justice part of this for me. There's always a kind of a social justice initiative on here, for I want to highlight some issue which to me will make women's issues better, or domination and oppression issues brought before. There's some kind of social justice that human development would always be improved by. So with that, we'll take some questions. Any thoughts? Somebody disagree?
No.
Yeah?
When playing the pieces that sounds like a Chopin, but it's not. In other electronic media, like visual arts, there's the concept of the uncanny valley, where something's really close, but it's not. And sometimes that has it has an effect on the viewer. I'm just wondering if there's anything in sound that evokes an emotion because it's close, but it's not. I don't know if there's.
I think what you're referring to, I mean, in film, they can animate live human bodies. If they get too close to an actual reproduction of a human physicality illusion, it drives people crazy, they can stand it. So they learn that when they make avatars, whatever, they have to be at least 5 to 10% different than a real form, because it's more comfortable to watch. There's something psychologically about human but not human. You can't be too close to human.
Right.
So, in music, I mean, there are people, once I tell like the piano majors in my class, when I tell them that it's not Chopin, it's a computer sort of extracted Chopin's intelligence and then wrote this piece, they're really upset. They get mad. Yeah, they get mad that somebody's doing that. Because they sort of have the sacredness around Chopin. I mean, Chopin's easy to model because he died young. So his work is all pretty much the same. He didn't really like Beethoven's very hard because there's the early Beethoven, there's the middle, there's the late. They're two different Beethovens. But when it comes that close, it's a good question. I don't know why they, I never really ask them why I'm upset, it just bothers them. Is that because it's and they didn't know that it wasn't. So it's not that factor, it's not that it's so close.
Yeah.
But it's the fact that they were just upset that somebody was trying to do that. And that there was something sacred about that, that it's only crossed the line. I mean, David Cope is talking about this, he's received death threats for this for years, from people who feel like he's messing with something that's in their mind sacred. Good question.
Speaking for myself, and I suspect for a great many other people in this room, I want to give my amazed thanks for introducing me to a world which I didn't even know existed.
Thanks. You've got ears, so you know this world.
It doesn't change the fact that probably still my favorite musical experience is to have heard the string quartet in Saint-Chapelle.
With 13 seconds of reverb right there.
Yeah. And if
mentioned something about evolutionary advantageous traits that certain effects of hockey could have. I'm curious to
the question here was, you mentioned something about his music and evolutionary adaptive function and other certain traits. I don't know that they're traits. I mean, people have tried to look for universals of music. You know, you hear people say, oh yeah, music is a universal language. That's not true. Music is universal, but just like Greek and English are not universal, you can't understand if you don't understand the vocabulary. You have to know the vocabulary. So when someone says, my music is universal, that's usually an essentialist, very arrogant kind of approach, I tend to think. It's usually from an imperialistic view. There are some qualities of universals that, I'm actually kind of sliding, quickly show you real fast. There are some qualities that people have discovered that do kind of point toward not specific universals, but things where you can detect qualities of music that do map pretty well. But these four quadrants, you can talk about positive or negative valence, where you have tenderness or happiness are both positive valence qualities, but yet they're different feelings. And when you look at music around the world, they tend to use similar qualities. Like tenderness, you have slow tempos, you have very small sound level variability, you have legato articulations, soft timbres, you know, there's a retardando at the end usually. There are certain parameters of the design of the sounds that are universal around the world. So Korea, Africa, wherever, if you want to do tenderness, they are different instruments, different scales, different harmonies, rhythms, all that's different. But those tend to fall out pretty consistently. So is that an innate, obviously it must be, there must be something in our cognitive psychology that is not about culture. Because the difference is in culture, but this is something that transcends culture. So, you know, a lot of people are looking at why is there music? And people have talked about, you know, music or sound, the meaning of sound is important to have a brain which can make sense of the world. And so the ears are the primary way the brain is processing sound more than it does anything else. And that's what cognitive, that's so fascinating about cognitive research. Like Alzheimer's patients, when they've lost the deterioration of the cognitive functions of language, vision, they can't really recognize their relatives anymore. But if they're trained musicians, many times they can sit and play, they can get on well to clear from memory. That music is stored throughout every part of the brain. That's what's so fascinating about this. And there's a lot of cognitive difference. So there's a lot of scientists are looking at is, does music have much more of an important part of our cognitive development than we realize? Because historically, it's always been important to be able to figure out who has the best gene pool for mating. So in certain species, you know, the male will make a sound like the macaques. Will make a sound, and whichever male has the best song gets the best female pool. So the song is telling them who has the best gene pool. I know that's true as musicians, happened to me, not myself. But then other questions for being able to detect fear or you know, that there's danger. All those kind of things were important, so that's the processing of sound, it's not music, but it's the processing of sound that is so central to who we are as a species, and that's why music carries such a robust set of operations and experiences on us.
Could you say a little bit about how the sonification work you did, how that worked out for the scientists?
Yeah, the performance was at Emory in the Schwartz Performing Arts Center. And it ended up being, because there were radio shows at Georgia Tech, there was a lot of big deal about Georgia Tech, so it was mostly Georgia Tech scientists that showed up in the concert. And it was so interesting because I was really worried about making this something that would be interesting for the scientists, but also I needed to be aesthetically pleasing as a performance. And it needed to be educational. So I had three different challenges to work into that. And it was interesting because I think I pissed off everybody. The scientists felt like it was too simplistic scientifically. They wanted more information about the science in it. The people at Emory, who are not scientists, who were there to hear our music concert, were totally confused. They thought it was just pure science and they didn't understand it. And then, I felt like trying to find the balance. People did learn a lot. You know, the scientists didn't learn much. So it was an interesting challenge. But I think the scientists loved it, the people who commissioned me, because I did it again the next year at a big international chemical convention, and it's been written up in several magazines. So it's kind of a new prototype. No one's ever tried to utilize a musical performance to satisfy the requirements of the NSF grants before. So I'm not sure how successful it was, but they're actually wanting me to do it again this spring because there's a big international science festival going on in Atlanta. So apparently that someone likes it.
So the sourcing for the, this is kind of expanding on Blake's question, the visual material that was part of that performance, that's also very important. I mean, it strikes me that a lot of the work requires a kind of audio-visual linking. I mean, it would be interesting to talk to, say, you know, like, I'm sort of losing my thread, but how do those two structures actually work at the level of understanding? I mean, are you expecting the person or hoping that the person will see the form and then be able to sort of extract into the audio? Is that, how does that sort of translation among intelligences work? Or are they sort of like coexisting the way that, say, dance and music might, oh, that's not really fair, but might coexist?
Yeah, good question. The sonification was really in the music.
Yeah.
And then the music evoked a lot of the visual images. So a lot of those were animations I had to do ahead of time, obviously. But there were some of the visual images which were coming from the sound into a program called Jitter, which plays in the Max.
So were you consulting with the scientists and developing those? Oh, I assumed they were sort of models the scientists had built.
You can imagine.
Okay.
I'll tell you they weren't. I mean, really what I was trying to do, I was trying to evoke the idea of what did the Earth feel like 3.5 million years ago. So when you walked into space, you know, you'd hear these sounds, which were modeled in the science, but yet you'd see images of things that were somewhat fanciful, because we don't know, I mean, the Earth was filled with a lot of meteorite activity, it was filled with a lot of volcanoes, it was methane atmosphere, so no one really understands which of those combinations created the basis for a chemical transformation into organic chemistry. And there's a lot of theories about it, but no one has been able to prove it. That's what these 20 or 30 research centers around the world are trying to figure out. And once they figure that out, if they can prove that just a basic chemical relationships under certain conditions can form the building blocks for life, then we can show that life can be anywhere in the universe, that those materials and those conditions might be present. So that's, you know, it's an important kind of thing to research. But right now, it's only speculation. And I think they just got it re-upped, because I had to go back and give a presentation to the NSF to kind of see, can they get another extension, another 5-year extension, another $40 million on the grant. So I think they've got that. So it's just an interesting process. But yeah, the lighting, which just kind of makes you feel like you're in some, you've left the planet. Yeah. That was the idea.
This is lecture was a lot about the relation between music and architecture. As you were explaining the process of your composition making, I was simultaneously thinking of the architects who use parametric design. I mean, there are different schools, but I'm particularly thinking of the ones who are doing this in big corporate architecture firms or big labs like MIT, and they disrupt the image of the author architect who works in a room individually, and rather it is an architect who works a lot with engineers and designs on the computer by changing numbers of parameters and so on. So I was thinking that you had a similar composition making process, and part of the motivation that these architects give as why this is necessary is the fact that now the whole clientele of architecture has changed. It happens with big money, the buildings are bigger than ever and higher than ever, so there's a necessity of a lot of engineering, intelligence and so on. But in a way, that happens in a world with big corporate firms, big money, big labs and so on. So I wonder if it's the case in music as well, as this parametric lineage that you are following up. Does it require funding and high tech, and how that relate to your social justice initiatives? How do you feel about it?
Yeah, I mean, what I'm showing in my history of my work has been primarily, I wanted to be very experimental. I wanted to be able to collaborate with people that I thought were interested to collaborate with, either scientists or choreographers or philosophers I'm collaborating with too. But I wanted to be able to explore certain topics that were important for me and to explore a design process that would be unique to that collaboration. So if there was a big corporation, if I was doing this as a condition, if I was working as a if there was already an economic system in place that I had to play into, if I was functioning as a designer hired by a client to produce something in this larger construct, I wouldn't be able to probably work in this format personally. I mean, this allows me the freedom to be able to kind of go to wherever the idea is driving to. And I guess that is, the larger the design firms you get into, you're going to be a cog into a very large set of principles that have very little chance for failure, and there's so much money involved in them, it's so big, you have to be fitting into a very developed algorithm for how it's going to work. I mean, all these processes you're seeing here had a very circuitous path as how they got developed, because I didn't really start out with a clear sense for what I had to do. I allowed myself to discover that as I went through the process. And that's sort of my choice as a kind of free artist who's not really being controlled by that kind of large corporate design environment. I don't want to answer your question. That's my preference. Okay, I think we'll get your question running again.
Well, we have UIC catering, which means it will close shop soon. So if you want to get drinks and food, we can continue the discussion with Steve upstairs.
Thank you.